Juggernaut was known in life as Horace Breaker Mahoney. Horace was born oversized and horribly disfigured, spending his childhood as an outcast. His mother abandoned him at an early age, and his father put him to work in their junkyard, where Horace's teenage years were spent alone, crushing and chopping up old cars. His father died, and with no parent to steer him, the 7-foot-tall giant snapped. His first kill was a pair of female hitchhikers. He drove them back to the junkyard and tore them apart with his bare hands, feeding the pieces to his dogs. Many more kills followed. His M.O. was towing stranded motorists back to the yard where he would meticulously break every bone in their bodies. But his luck ran out, as it always does, the night he picked up an undercover female cop. It took over a dozen men to subdue the immense giant, three of whom lost their lives when Horace broke free of his handcuffs. But poor Horace's struggle eventually ended when 5 officers pumped nearly 50 rounds of ammo into him, and then another clip into his lifeless corpse, just to be sure. The bound woman's name was Susan LeGros. Born with a silver spoon in her mouth, Susan had it all. Her parents were the wealthiest people in town, which made Susan the most popular girl at school. Life couldn't have been more perfect, but Susan's one flaw was how she treated men. Flirting and toying with whomever she chose, she left a long trail of broken hearts. Her friends warned she'd live to regret her ways, and they were half right. In Susan's senior year, she dated the star football player Chet Walters. The night of the senior prom, Chet caught his prom queen in another boy's arms. The next morning, the boy was found clubbed to death, and Susan was missing. 2 weeks later, Susan's body was found, buried beneath the football field's 50-yard line, bound in rope and strangled to death. Arrested and put on death row, Chet's last words were, "The bitch broke my heart, so I broke her neck." That jealous monster would have made a nice compliment alongside Susan. Such wretched words and behavior, but his results were quite fitting. Most people have gambled at least once in their life, but for Jimmy the Gambler Gambino, betting was his life and death. The son of a bookie, Jimmy spent his childhood days at the track instead of at school, and his nights in the gambling dens of seedy bars. Eventually, Jimmy opened a booking business of his own. Unable to turn down a bet, he barely covered his payoffs. Jimmy's reputation caught the attention of made man Larry the Finger Vitello. Larry approached Jimmy to place a large bet on the long shot in a heavyweight fight. Jimmy knew the risk, but needed to uphold his reputation. So he shook hands with Larry and sealed his fate. As his fighter took a deciding blow, Jimmy fainted to the floor. When Jimmy came to, Larry had arrived to collect his winnings, but Jimmy was cleaned out, so Larry made an example out of him. Actually, several small examples. He chopped him into little pieces, wrapping them in cellophane and dumping them into the ocean. Together they formed the pieces which completed my search for the torso. Miss Isabella Smith was my choice for The Pilgrimess. Her story began in 1675 when the orphan Isabella journeyed from England in the hope of finding a comfortable home in a quaint New England town. But problems began soon after she arrived. The tight-knit townsfolk didn't trust outsiders. When their livestock started to die mysteriously, the town's preacher accused Isabella of witchcraft. She denied the claim, but the town quickly turned against her. As more livestock fell ill, the preacher acquired a mysterious illness. The town rallied into a frenzy, cornering Isabella in a farmhouse, which they lit on fire. But moments later, Isabella miraculously crawled out, still alive, and without a single burn upon her skin. The astounded townsfolk sentenced her to a slow death in the stocks. There she stayed for weeks while children stoned her, women cursed her, and men spat on her. The humiliation proved worse than the pain. Finally, Isabella succumbed to starvation. Whether or not she was a witch, I can't say, but her powerful anguish served my needs well. strangest ghosts I caught had to be Harold Shelburne, the great child. His 3-foot-tall mother, Margaret Shelburne, was wildly overprotective of her son, smothering and spoiling him from infancy, and never stopping as he grew. Harold could barely care for himself, and as a result, remained in diapers his entire life. Mocked at every turn, they sought refuge with a traveling freak show run by a man named Jimbo. But even a life in the circus was no escape, as they were continually taunted and tormented by their own twisted kind. One night, some of the freaks kidnapped Margaret as a cruel joke. In a panic-fueled rage, Harold destroyed the entire carnival in search of his mother. When he finally found her, she had died of suffocation. Filled with hatred, Harold grabbed an axe and had his revenge on the freaks, displaying what was left of them in the carnival for every paying customer to see. When Jimbo found out what had happened, he had Harold mutilated beyond what you or I can comprehend. Well, maybe you. And you thought your family was weird. Ryan Q, the man who became the Jackal, was born in 1887 to a prostitute. Ryan later developed a sick and insatiable appetite for the female gender, attacking prostitutes and stray women with the cunning of a wild animal. As a means to cure his insatiable appetite, Ryan committed himself to Boreham Asylum. After years of imprisonment in a padded room, he went completely insane, scratching at the walls so violently that his fingernails were torn completely off. The doctors kept him permanently bound in a straitjacket, tying it tighter when he acted out, causing his limbs to contort horribly. Still fighting to free himself, Ryan gnawed through his straitjacket until the doctors finally locked his head in a cage and sealed him away in a dark basement cell. There, he grew to hate any kind of human contact, screaming madly and cowering whenever approached by people. When a fire broke out in the asylum, everyone but Ryan escaped. He chose to stay behind and meet his deserved fate. George Markley was a happy, honest blacksmith in the early 1890s before the horrific events that transformed him into the Hammer. A hard-working man named Nathan wrongfully accused Mr. Markley of stealing and threatened to run him out of their booming town. Knowing he was innocent, George stood up to Nathan and refused to move. One day, when George's wife and 2 children were walking home from the market, Nathan and his gang of thugs attacked them, brutally killing them. Enraged, George tracked down Nathan and his friends and beat them to a pulp with his massive blacksmith's hammer. The local townspeople captured George and dragged him back to his shop, where he received a brutal form of frontier justice. Tied to a tree, nails were driven deep into his body with his own hammer. They finished the job by cutting off his most prized possession, his hand. Crudely fastened to his severed appendage was the tool of his livelihood, the hammer, readied for one last chance at vengeance. The angry princess was a young woman whose beauty became her ruin. Dana Newman was blessed with the natural looks of a goddess, but cursed with an inability to recognize it. Her vanity and insecurity was only fueled by a string of abusive boyfriends. By the time of her 20s, depression had dragged Dana into a downward spiral of self-loathing that doctors struggled to save her from. Her desperate search for perfection led to employment with a plastic surgeon, where her wage was paid in nose jobs, breast implants, and an endless array of other needless procedures. Alone in the office one night, Dana tried to perform surgery on herself in a desperate attempt to remove an unperceivable imperfection on her face. The unorthodox procedure went horribly wrong, and she was left blinded in one eye. She finally gave up on achieving perfection and mutilated herself in a bathtub until her veins ran dry. When they found her, they said that she was as beautiful in death as she was in life. My easiest choice had to have been the withered lover, considering Jean Criticos was my nephew's wife. Her burnt and tortured soul held just the magnitude of suffering I required. As a wife and mother, Jean was loving and devoted, I must say that my nephew married a wonderful and proper woman. But their happiness came to a fiery end one fateful night. After decorating the family Christmas tree, the family had snuggled together in front of a roaring fire. In the dead of the night, a still smoldering log rolled out onto the carpet, igniting it instantly. The smoke alarm sent Arthur into one of his famous panics. He rushed down the hall to save his children, assuming, of course, that his wife would head outside. Arthur soon realized he had assumed wrong. The firemen kept Jean's family from going back in after her. Poor Arthur was devastated by not saving her, but her oh-so-tragic death served my needs perfectly. Margaret Shelburne, the dire mother, was a shy woman who could never stand up for herself, partly because she rose to only a mere 3 feet in height. Since childhood, she was stared at for her pint size. Her own mother would even sometimes dress her like a doll. Margaret didn't care, as long as she found some perverse form of acceptance. A carnival barker named Jimbo put her on display in his freak show. Life was horrible, being an attraction for people to gawk at. One night, while sweeping up a donkey pen, she was raped by the tall man. She spawned a beastly offspring of her own. Oh, she loved her dear son Harold more than life itself, never letting him out of her sight. The circus workers teased and tormented them relentlessly, a conflict that played itself out with bloody resolve that left nearly the entire circus free of life, including poor Margaret and Harold. Well, as they say, there's no business like show business. Before he became my firstborn son, little Billy Michaels was simply a stubborn brat. His obsession with the world of cowboys and Indians took precedent over all else. Any attempt to drag Billy out of his fantasy world sent him flying into a rage. His parents thought it all a harmless phase, until the day that a neighbor boy discovered a real bow and arrow in his father's closet and taunted the notorious cowboy Billy into a duel. But Billy's toy cap gun was no match for the steel-tipped arrow that took his life. His rebellious attitude and refusal to accept defeat was a perfect fit for my violent circle of angry spirits. The Torn Prince was a boy born in 1940 by the name of Royce Clayton. At 17, Royce was a star slugger on his baseball team. Every college in the country courted him, all offering first-class tickets out of his miserable small-town life. But fate threw Royce a curveball in the form of a local greaser who challenged him to a drag. Royce held his own for the first half mile, then suddenly lost control of his little sweetheart. The hot rod flipped 3 times before bursting into flames. His peers watched in horror as the fire engulfed their fallen hero. Needless to say, he never escaped his small-town life. His remains still buried in a small plot overlooking his beloved ball field.